We will have a summit during our presidency in February, an energy summit. We would like to have an informal energy council hosted in Hungary to prepare it. And I think by this we could do a lot to move towards a common energy policy. We are very committed to start the discussion on the next financial perspective. The financial perspective, which starts from 2014, will decide about the fate of the common policies. We would be very honored to start this discussion, the political orientation debate we would like to be during our presidency. There are a lot of discussions going on about the timing. Some member states would prefer to have a very short discussion. I don't think it's the right approach. I think we should dedicate as much time as necessary for a good debate. We would like to sign the accession treaty with Croatia. The Spanish presidency did a great job in that field. They opened a remarkable number of chapters. We very much hope that during the Belgian presidency, as it was already emphasized by Monsieur Chastel, the progress will go on, and we will be able to, if it's necessary, finish the negotiations and definitely sign with Croatia. Of course, they have to do their job at home, but there is always a need. As a new, someone coming from a new member state, we always know that the political will is a very important factor when these kind of decisions are taken. We also are very interested in opening the Schengen area to two more member states, Romania and Bulgaria. The technical preparations have to be done during the Belgian presidency, and we very much hope that in the relevant council we will be able to give this positive signal to these two countries. In June, in a year time, we hope to approve the Danube strategy, which is a new macro-region initiative in Europe, modeled on the Baltic strategy, which again encourages member states to work together on certain issues. The Danube strategy is about energy, is about transport, is about drinking water, it's about culture. It's a very complex issue, and I hope that we will be able to finish and approve this strategy. And then I already mentioned this, colleagues, that on the basis of our very well designed and shaped TRIO program, we will present them some proposals on which work could be done already during the Belgian presidency, and we could make progress on those issues. The first one is water policy. Water is a treasure in Europe. I think we should talk more about it. We could launch more initiatives at European level, and we will put first our proposals on the table of the TRIO to discuss it among us, and then put it into the usual EU tube. The same is for cultural diversity. We think it's an asset in Europe, it's something that's very close to the people, and if we want a Europe which is close to the citizens and it speaks about problems on cultural diversity, on promoting cultural diversity, on having common actions, I think we could do a lot. I would like to thank the cooperation which has been already demonstrated by our partners. I'm especially thankful to Minister Garrido for having very fruitful consultations on many important subjects, on agriculture, on social issues. Even bilaterally, our experts have been working together very efficiently in the last months. I think that's also a common result that in the last European Council conclusions, agriculture and the cohesion policy were included. This is an issue which is important for all of us. I don't think that the Europe of the 21st century could live without these policies. Actually, it was not easy to convince all our partners, I mean, outside the TRIO, that we need the common agricultural policy. We need cohesion because Europe cannot be competitive at world level without having a good cohesion policy. And just speaking about the new challenges would not replace the existing policies. Of course, it doesn't mean that we cannot do more on the traditional common policies, but I think they cannot be neglected. And in this, even in that respect, our Spanish colleagues did an extremely good job during their presidency. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias, Anika. Bueno, has planteado una serie de temas realmente importantes. Faltan todavía 6 meses para que empiece la presidencia húngara, pero ya tienen muy claro las cosas que quieren priorizar. Y como ven, hay una gran compenetración y sincronización entre los elementos que queremos destacar, o que hemos destacado en presidencia española, que pues, se va a hacer en presidencia belga y luego húngara, porque tiene, como decía Olivier, tiene esa base importante de un trabajo que realizamos mucho antes de empezar la presidencia española, mucho antes de empezar el trío de presidencias, un trabajo conjunto que ha hecho que el programa del trío sea un programa maduro y que sea sin duda uno de los ejes, una de las columnas vertebrales de nuestras presidencias y, por tanto, de la Unión Europea, que en definitiva es quien se beneficia de estas presidencias. Bien, pues ahora estamos a su disposición por si quieren algunos de ustedes hacer alguna pregunta.
Sí. Buenas tardes, soy Luisa de Radio Francia Internacional. Quisiera saber para usted cuál fue la mayor dificultad de la presidencia española, del turno español. E incluso en un momento que, bueno, España ha pasado por algunos momentos difíciles desde el punto de vista económico, altas tasas de paro, algunas crisis de credibilidad y, bueno, entonces me gustaría saber eso, cuáles fueron las mayores dificultades de España. Gracias.
Bueno, España ha tenido la ayuda, tengo que decirlo, la ayuda de Bélgica y de Hungría, en primer lugar. Por tanto, cuando hablamos de dificultades, decir que las que haya podido haber, yo voy a referirme a la que me parece que ha sido más destacada, hay que poner de relieve que se han logrado superar esas dificultades porque hemos tenido la ayuda de nuestros colegas de trigo y de todos los miembros de la Unión Europea, de los 26 países miembros de la Unión, así como de las instituciones y de las nuevas instituciones, no solo de las viejas, sino de las nuevas instituciones, como es el caso del presidente del Consejo Europeo y la alta representante. Bueno, me parece que la mayor dificultad en estos meses ha sido cómo enfrentar una crisis económica que ha adquirido, yo creo, su punto álgido, precisamente en este tiempo, porque a la crisis financiera inicial se ha añadido una crisis económica recesiva que ha sufrido la Unión Europea y como consecuencia de la inmediata reacción y ayuda que los Estados han dado a sus economías y como consecuencia de la ayuda que los Estados han dado a las personas más vulnerables, más dañadas, por ejemplo, trabajadores en paro, pues ha dado lugar a un déficit importante de los países miembros de la Unión Europea, casi todos ellos. Hay 22 países en déficit excesivo en estos momentos, en procedimiento de déficit excesivo, y la consecuencia ha sido lo que se ha dado en llamar la crisis de las deudas soberanas, que incluso produjo una situación extremadamente dramática para Grecia, un país de la eurozona. Creo que ese ha sido el momento más difícil de esta presidencia, cómo gestionar esta crisis de deudas soberanas, cómo gestionar un momento en el que los mercados financieros han sido extremadamente volátiles, irregulares, inestables, afectando, por tanto, indirectamente o a veces de forma directa, a la estabilidad del conjunto de la Unión o de la zona euro específicamente. Y afortunadamente la Unión Europea, a través de decisiones